Hello and welcome to this video. Today you are going to Porto, Portugal. I am not going because I am already there. This is my city and it was the venue for the first Portuguese F1 Grand Prix in 1958 and also in 1960. Today we are going to the Boavista F1 circuit. Are you ready? Let's go! In this video, I will cover all the races held here in Porto, and that totals more than 100 years of history. This is a long video and you have timestamps, so you can go to a particular section whenever you want. This video really gave a lot of work. I would like to thank the help of the Automobile Club of Portugal. We call it Automóvel Club de Portugal. I also would like to thank the help and input of Armando Costa. He was the race director of the 2009 race. And José Barros Rodrigues, author of the book Velocidade na Invicta, among other books. This video certainly would not be complete without their help and input. Let's begin. The city of Porto, also known as Oporto, the second largest city in the country, is one of the oldest European cities and has more than 1,000 years of history. Known as the city of initiative and hard work, this is a city where tradition and honor are still things that mean something. Therefore, it is no wonder that the city paid tribute and homage to some of the great drivers who raced and or won in the Boavista circuit. Located on the outer part of the former Turn 1, these plates are arranged in two semicircles and where Stirling Moss is at the top, in the center of the outer semicircle. It is a form of recognition for his victory in the first race held here, but above all, for the incredible sportsmanship that he had in 1958, something that rarely happens. Here, we still know how to appreciate these gestures. The first races in the city. The first car race in this city took place in 1910 at the newly opened Royal Velodrome Dona Amélia, right in the city center and during the very last days of monarchy in this country. It is located at the back of a palace acquired by the king to spend the night during his visits to the city. At the time, cycling was a recent and very popular sport, and the king decided to sponsor it by creating the velodrome. It was an event with a car and a horse race. The event was a great success and marked the beginning of an era. It was a funny event in that the horses and the cars didn't have very different speeds and were still equivalent, as you can see in the pictures. It should be noted that this velodrome still exists, right in the city center, behind one of the biggest museums in the city. After the fall of the monarchy, it was abandoned and forgotten. It was restored in 2001, but currently its entrance is closed to the public. In 1912 and 13, the first race was held on the streets of the city as a part of a rally around the north of Portugal, first and second Circuito Automóvel do Minho. It started and ended here. After the race, the cars were exhibited at the Palácio de Cristal, or in English, Crystal Palace. That led to the first automobile exhibition organized in the country in 1914 at the Palácio de Cristal. This exhibition was a huge success and would be repeated annually until 1951. In 1937, the beautiful and stunning roadster EDFOR, created by Eduardo Ferreirinha, was shown there for the very first time. Boavista's motorsport tradition begins in the 1920s, when the launched kilometers were organized in 1923 and 25. In 1923, the winner was Abílio Nunes dos Santos, and in that race, the best Portuguese drivers of the time were present, like Henrique Lerfeld, Eduardo Ferreirinha, the driver and aviator Carlos Eduardo Black, and even Jorge Novais, the future leader of the Automobile Club of Portugal and the true soul and driving force of the Boavista circuit. In 1926, the first Rampa da Circunvalação was run on a rainy day, and the race class was won by Eduardo Ferreirinha driving a Bugatti. In 1931, the new sport commission of the Automobile Club of Portugal, which from now on I will simply call ACP, started a huge work on the motorsport side. It was led by the then president Dr. Mário Madeira, and it was composed of Alfredo Marinho, Engenheiro Roberto Cudel, Oscar Chambers, Vasco Irmida, Alfredo Cunha and Jorge Novais. As a result, the first edition of this automobile circuit, with the formal name of Circuito da Boavista, Boavista Circuit, took place in 1931. It had some singularities. To determine the winner, the handicap system was used, as was used in Brooklands at the time, for the first and last time in our country, as it was very controversial. And the circuit consisted of two long straights on the side lanes of the Boavista Avenue, joined by two curves with a radius of 10 meters. This competition was won by Fernando Palhinhas at the wheel of a Singer 9, curiously one of the drivers with the greatest handicap, which meant that he only had to cover 30 laps instead of the 50 defined for the circuit. In the following 2 years, 1932 and 33, the race was won by whoever covered the longest distance in a fixed time of 90 minutes divided in two distinct classes, sport and race. 1932-33. In July 1932, the second Boavista circuit was disputed with a special highlight and absolute novelty at national level, with the participation of a lady, Dona Palmira Coelho, at the wheel of an Opel. She was very applauded, cheered, and supported by the audience. There were two races with a total of 21 competitors. Given the start of the sport race, the Invicta car of Vasco Sameiro took the lead, being closely followed during the first lap by Mário Ferreira, Gaspar Sameiro and Artur Barbosa. The latter retired on the second lap because he lost the gas tank. On the 23rd lap, it was Manuel Ribas Austin to overturn, without major consequences for the driver. Dona Palmira Coelho, the only lady in the race, finished in an honorable 10th place, with a remarkable average of 70 km per hour. In 1933, the third edition of the Circuito da Boavista was marked by the competition between the best drivers of the time, Vasco Sameiro, known as the Red Devil, in an Alfa Romeo 8C 2300, and Henrique Lerfeld in a Bugatti 35B that still runs and is displayed in the Caramulo Museum. And also the motorcycle race, with the participation of 13 motorcycles in the 350cc and 500cc versions. Already at this stage, motorsport threatened to become a very popular event, as evidenced by the number of spectators present, around 12,000. The race was not the best, as Lerfeld had to stop to check the brakes and change a wheel, and Vasco Sameiro easily won the race. Also in the 30s, there was a study to expand the circuit to a triangular shape, like Spa or Reims, but unfortunately it was just an idea that would never take shape. At the time, it would be an amazing fast circuit like Reims, but run inside the city streets, like in Monaco. But in 1934, in a race in Espinho, a city a few kilometers south of Porto, there was an accident on lap 54, and it ended with 5 dead and lots of injured. The ACP Sport Commission, the organizer of that race, decided to cancel all races and activity for that year after that incident, as a mark of respect for the victims. In 1946, Dr. Mário Madeira, president of the ACP, was elected to FIA vice president. 1950. The year of 1950 marked a turning point in the Boavista circuit. Remember that, at the time, Europe was still rebuilding itself after the destruction of World War II, and Portugal was neutral in the conflict, so no destruction here. Although not rich, the country was having some stability at the financial level and could afford to start some international races. Thanks to the great work of the North Sport Commission of the ACP, composed by De Conde de Covilhã, Alfredo Marinho Jr., Jorge Novais, the true soul of the circuit, Anselmo Mancelos, Arnaldo Torres, with the support of the president, Dr. Mário Madeira, and the rest of the ACP Commission, Engenheiro Ribeiro Ferreira, Tomás Pinto Basto, Engenheiro João Corte, Xavier Almeida, the circuit was reconfigured and resized with a new layout of 7,775 meters, to which the inclusion of new streets and roads contributed greatly, as was the case with Estrada da Circunvalação, the city's external ring. The first Porto International Circuit was then created, which ran in the city on June 18, 1950. Several teams were contacted and paid by the ACP thanks to the contacts of Engenheiro Walter Cudel with the British and German teams and the contacts of Giuseppe Trevisan with the Italian and French teams. Trevisan had direct connection to the Commendatore Ferrari, something that was difficult. Some of the old drivers that raced here in the 30s also participated in this race. In this first international initiative, it is worth highlighting that Ferrari made its debut in our country in this race with two cars, one being driven by a woman, Yvonne Simon, who finished in fourth place, and one Ferrari 166 Barchetta, driven by Giovanni Bracco, who retired. The motorcycle race, held the day before the cars on June 17, in the 350 and 500cc categories, and a large influx of public, around 150,000 people. With all this, the winner of the first Porto International Circuit was Italian Felice Bonetto, at the wheel of an old Alfa Romeo 412, who started from the last place due to missing the timing practice and did the last 100 meters without gas before crossing the finish line. And the best story of this race, Felice Bonetto, to be present in this race, came alone, driving his car with no support whatsoever from Italy to Porto, and he took 23 hours. He arrived at the middle of the night before the race and wanted to align his car's steering for the race. So, at 3 a.m., he knocked at the CONI representative, the ECV garage's door, where Carlos Bessa called his employees to come and attend the Italian. You simply cannot do that today. 1951. Due to the enormous success of the first edition, the second Porto International Circuit, held on June 17, 1951, had generated quite high expectations, to which the ACP responded with a bold program, even more attractive in number and quality, with the designation of First Grand Prix of Portugal. Of the approximately 30 expected drivers, 16 were foreigners, demonstrating the potential and strength of this race at an external level. This race was won by a Portuguese, Casimiro de Oliveira, at the wheel of a Ferrari 340 America Berlinetta, which he had just received 3 days before the race. Special mention to the presence of King Umberto of Italy, exiled in Portugal at the time, and the number of spectators estimated at around 100,000. This was the last race with this original long configuration with 7,775 meters. 1952. With some changes made to the circuit, such as the elimination of the narrow Preciosa Street, the creation and opening of the new Lidador Street, and the installation of 4 grandstands, a tribune of honor, 4 bridges, and 5 parking lots, the second Grand Prix of Portugal and the third International Circuit of Porto became more and more a social and entertainment event. The race was extended to 50 laps with a total distance of 370 kilometers. Unfortunately, the response in terms of attendance was far below expectations, between 30 and 40,000 spectators. The motorcycle race was won by the same competitor in both 350 and 500cc classes, the Spaniard Javier Ortueta. In cars, it was won by Italian Eugenio Castellotti in a Ferrari 225S, beating Casimiro de Oliveira in a race where Ferrari dominated as the top 6 placed teams lined up with cars from this brand. It was only in this year that wearing a helmet has become mandatory. 1953. Earlier this year, the World Manufacturers Championship for Sports Cars was created, to which the main manufacturers immediately joined. The Automobile Club of Portugal then took a very relevant decision by creating a second competition, parallel to the Grand Prix of Portugal, called City of Porto Cup, aimed at sports car vehicles up to 1100cc. In earlier years, all cars raced together in one race. The creation of this race helped to consolidate the work of the pioneering Portuguese builders and stimulated the appearance of others. With 20 cars entered, 13 were driving Portuguese-made cars, with exception for the Etnerap, which was built in Lisbon. These cars were all built around this region, so they were racing at home ground. These guys could not buy expensive racing machinery, so to be able to race, they did build their own cars. My full respect to them. This year, the race was extended again to 60 laps or 444 kilometers and was particularly marked by lots of rain and numerous serious accidents, mainly the Ferrari of Vasco Sameiro, the Jaguar Type C of Duncan Hamilton, who had won the Le Mans 24 Hours race 1 week earlier and was participating in this race for the third time, and the Aston Martin DB3 of Tony Gaze, fortunately all without any fatalities. The winner of this Grand Prix was a Portuguese, José Nogueira Pinto, at the wheel of a 3-litre Ferrari 250mm Barchetta, beating Casimir de Oliveira on a similar car. Once again, the Italian brand dominated. In the City of Porto Cup, Francisco Corte Real Pereira won with his Alba, which is the first and only car 100% made in Portugal. This beautiful car is currently in the Caramulo Car Museum. Highlight for the inscription of Jean Redelet, future creator of Alpine, in a Renault 4CV. Casimiro de Oliveira. In 1953, he was in Modena and tested the Ferrari F2 with a 2-liter engine. After the rules changed in 1952, this single-seater dominated the Formula One World Championship with Alberto Ascari for 2 years. Thus, Casimiro was the first Portuguese driver to drive an F1 car, despite only in private testing. 1954. First, a mention to the death of the Italian Giuseppe Trevisan, collaborator of the ACP, and that was the bridge between the Portuguese and the Italian teams, particularly Ferrari. He had a personal relationship with Enzo Ferrari. With the entry into the scene of the Monsanto circuit in Lisbon, the Grand Prix of Portugal was transferred to the capital with the Boavista circuit under a different name. First Grand Prix of Porto, held on the 26th and 27th of June 1954, with a total of 35 laps for the Grand Prix and 15 for the City of Porto Cup. There was a dominance of Lancia, with the factory Italian team taking the first 2 places, with the Italian Luigi Villoresi in a D24 coming out the winner, beating Eugenio Castellotti. The world champion, the Italian Alberto Ascari, participated this year, although he retired 6 laps from the end when he was leading. That impeded the Lancia 1-2-3 result. The fastest lap was set by Castellotti with an average of 152.6 km per hour. In the second City of Porto Cup, the winner was the Portuguese Ernesto Martorell with an Austrian Denzel car, model 1500, and this brand also got the 2nd place. For the first time since it was organized, the Boavista circuit made a profit, and the City of Porto Cup was a determining factor for this. The race regulation changed, allowing the helmet to be optional in closed cars. Unfortunately, in a strategic move with ruinous consequences, the ACP, pressured by financially healthy drivers from the Lisbon area, who bought the new Denzel Porsche 1500cc, extended the upper limit of the sport class reserved for small displacements to 1500cc, allowing the Denzels first and Porsches later to decimate the competition and the very interest of racing. For this reason, from 1954 onwards, Portuguese builders that used Fiat or Simca 1100cc engines were forced to develop their engines in a direction for which they were neither prepared nor had the financial capacity to do so. The increase in cylinder capacity by increasing the diameter of the cylinders. It was the beginning of the end for these pioneers. 1955. This year, in an unexpected turn, the 6th International Circuit of Porto once again hosted the 5th edition of the Grand Prix of Portugal with a total of 55 laps. Of the 22 registered drivers, 7 were Portuguese and all of them drove Ferrari cars. 2 of them, Vasco Sameiro and Casimiro de Oliveira, driving a Ferrari 750 Monza, had the misfortune of being involved in 2 serious accidents in almost the same place, which almost completely destroyed their vehicles and certainly finished their careers. In one go, Portugal lost its best 2 racing drivers of the time. The possible cause for those crashes was the lack of adaptation to the new auto-blocking differentials that were much more active on that car. Remember that Alberto Ascari also died driving this car. There was also the debut of the Italian brand Maserati in Porto, with a victory in the race, thanks to the French driver Jean Berrat, who was driving a 300S model. He lapped everybody and beat Mastin Gregory driving a Ferrari 750 Monza and Duncan Hamilton on a Jaguar Type D. In the City of Porto Cup, the winner was the German brand Porsche, with the Portuguese Joaquim Filipe Nogueira driving a Porsche 550 Spyder. Note for the presence for the first time of a Portuguese car that ran with a Portuguese-made 1500cc engine, but the Alba driver was not lucky retiring. That car would eventually win two national events later with that engine. Anyway, after the rules change 1 year before, the wave of pioneers that started a few years before, building or transforming cars to race, was now slowly dying due to the lack of competitiveness against the Porsches and Denzels with larger engines. 1956. On June 17 of this year, the last edition in the Sport class took place, in which only four Portuguese were registered, as the ACP already had in mind to bring Formula 1 to this circuit. It returned to the name Grand Prix of Porto, in this case in its second edition, having counted for the first time with motorcycle races with sidecars, in addition to the usual car and motorcycle races. The Boavista circuit was shorter in distance, defined with only 40 laps for the Grand Prix and 20 laps for the City Cup. Also noteworthy was the debut of the British brand Lotus and the driver Jack Brabham in a Cooper Climax, as well as the presence of 5 Spanish and 3 Swiss pilots, countries that until now had placed this race in the background. This edition was also marked by the dominance, once again, of the Italian brands, Ferrari and Maserati, with the victory of the Spaniard Marquez de Portago in a Ferrari 875. Phil Hill, driving a Ferrari 857S, was second. Notes for the huge crashes of Filipe Nogueira and Fernando Mascarenhas, both on a Ferrari 750 Monza. The first was disputing the lead with De Portago for almost the whole race, despite having a slower car. This race ran without the presence of the official Italian teams due to lack of funds agreement with the ACP, and was possibly the best ever race in this circuit. In the City Cup, Roy Salvadori won in a Cooper Climax in a race where only 3 of the 19 drivers present were driving Portuguese machinery. In 1957 and 59, the Grand Prix was not run in Porto, as the financial losses and the logistic work for the ACP to organize 2 Grand Prix in the same year was becoming difficult to support. It was run in the Monsanto track in Lisbon, and this is when they start alternating the Grand Prix of Portugal between the two cities. 1958. On August 24, 1958, Formula 1 finally arrived in Portugal for the first Portuguese Grand Prix that was attended by more than 100,000 people. Note that the previous races held here have all been for sports cars and, strictly speaking, not Grand Prix races at all. A debut with the appearance of names such as Stirling Moss, Mike Hawthorn, Jack Brabham, Graham Hill, and the first woman to drive a Formula One, Maria Teresa de Filippis, among many others. Unfortunately, Fangio had retired after the race at Reims in France and did not compete here. At the time, there were several non-championship races, but Portugal was entitled to the complete package. The Grand Prix of Portugal would be the 9th race counting for the Drivers and Constructors World Championships, the latter created for the first time that season. The Boavista circuit was then experiencing one of the highest moments in its history, announced by the ACP and sponsored by the Argentine driver Fangio, an initiative already tried in other countries was carried out, without success, which aimed to sponsor new brands and drivers, called Formula Junior. It was run instead of the previous year's City Cup. However, the differences between the 11 cars that participated were evident, and the controversy ended up overcoming the potential and positive aspects that this formula could contain. This race was won by the local rookie Nogueira Pinto Jr. on a car that he never drove before. This year, Mike Hawthorn and Stirling Moss were battling fiercely for the title of champion, with Porto being the first of the three remaining races, therefore an important race for the contenders. The circuit of Porto was a true road circuit and one of the last of the real street races, containing all the normal hazards of a town, including tram lines, curbstones, cobbles, drains, trees, lamp posts, pillar boxes, and so on. Those drivers who had not seen it before were slightly taken aback, because it was fast and long, while those who had driven in previous sports car races wondered how much faster the Grand Prix cars would turn the lap. From the start, the pits were on the right, and the circuit entered a vast roundabout or open place, paved with cobblestones, making a double left turn across tram lines in the opposite direction to normal traffic, and turned up the Boavista Avenue that lent its name to the circuit. This was a long double track road with a tramway down the center, and the circuit ran up the left-hand carriageway, going uphill and dead straight. After a little more than 2 kilometers, it swung sharp left into another climbing main road, Avenida Antunes Guimarães. That avenue was surfaced with cobbles and had tram lines on the right-hand side. Just short of a kilometer, the road leveled out, and the circuit turned left again into a narrow side turning and an even narrower residential street between houses and shops. After sweeping right and left, the route joined a very smooth surfaced, high-speed, winding descent, where the drivers had to negotiate several bends of both directions, with varying degrees of arc and radius. This is called Estrada da Circunvalação, or the City External Ring. The drivers were pretty much unanimous in feeling that this last stretch made the circuit worthwhile. The thin road ran back down to the seafront, where a double left sweep across more tram lines and cobbles brought the road into the short start-finish straight. It was not a difficult circuit to learn from the point of view of shape and direction, but many of the corners left a number of different approaches available, whether to dodge the tram lines or the bumps, or both, or ignore both, and so on. First practice was Friday afternoon, under quite hot conditions, and it started with everyone feeling their way round, as there were no standard time to aim at, this being the first appearance of Grand Prix cars at Porto. Sports cars had lapped at under 3 minutes. Brooks and Lewis Evans were supporting Moss in the van walls. Hawthorn was driving a Ferrari, and Von Trips had the experimental Monza Ferrari with rear coil springing. Shell and Berra were in the BRMs, and there were three Coopers, Brabham and Salvadori in the works cars, and Trontignan in the Walker Cooper, while Ellison and Hill had the 1958 works Lotus cars. the first lady driver, the Philippines, and Bonnier were out in their own private Maseratis, and Carroll Shelby was driving the 1958 Maserati works car, which, since Reims, had been bought by Temple Boyle. The Centro Sud Scuderia had one car at the pits, but no driver, as the American Troy Ruttmann had not turned up. Lap speeds were increasingly steady among the fast works drivers, though it was interesting to see the variations in tackling the double left bend after the pits, where the cars had to cross the tram lines once or twice depending on the line taken. While this was going on, there was a moment of panic when the Philippines spun her Maserati and collected a lamp post, both the concrete pole and the Maserati chassis being put very out of shape. But the Italian was quite unhurt. Next day there was another afternoon practice, under a hot sun, and one or two changes had been made into the entry list. This is another amazing story, only possible in those times. With the Lotus being an unrepairable bunch of bits, Allison contracted to drive the Centro Sud Maserati, as Troy Ruttmann was obviously not going to turn up, and the Philippines borrowed Jerini's Maserati, which he had brought along in the hope of getting a late entry. Graham Hill, in the lone Lotus, was steadily improving his times, and the Van Walls were sitting back for a bit of watching. Meanwhile, Salvadori had been steadily working away with the 2-liter Cooper, and though he eventually almost broke 2 minutes 43 seconds, he could not approach Trentinger with the old Walker 2-liter Cooper. Trentinger's best time of 2 minutes 37.97 seconds with the 2-liter Cooper was not a single lucky lap, because he was turning consistent laps at 2 minutes 38 seconds. Moss went out again and now began to try everything and approached 2 minutes 34, while Berra began to menace with laps at only a little over 2 minutes 35 seconds. But Moss then finished his efforts with 2 minutes 34.21 seconds, which just beat Hawthorne's best and got him pole position. Everything looked well for race day. However, overnight, the rains came, and all Sunday morning saw Porto covered in a miserable, drizzling rain. Luckily, the start was due to be at 4 p.m., and after lunch, the rain stopped, though the skies were still very grey. As the cars and drivers assembled at the pits, there did seem a chance of the roads drying out, and by the time everyone was in their place on the grid, the weather was so promising and every vantage point was packed. As the 15 cars left the line and headed across the open space of the roundabout, making for the bottleneck of the Avenida da Boavista, it was Moss who took the lead, and at the end of lap 1 he led Hawthorne, Van Trips, Schell, Lewis Evans, Berra, Brabham and Brooks, all following one another in quick succession, and obviously treading cautiously on the still damp track. Going up the double track road, Hawthorne went by the leading Van Wall and finished the second lap with quite a lead on Moss, while Schell, Van Trips and Lewis Evans followed nose to tail, with Berra not far behind. The gap between Hawthorne and Moss was unchanged on the next lap, and on lap 5 Moss closed visibly on Hawthorne, for the roads were drying fast and he had got the measure of the circuit, and Berra was now after Van Trips, who was in third place 22 seconds behind Moss. On laps 6 and 7, Moss was right behind Hawthorne, the two of them being way out on their own, and Berra was pressing hard on the tail of Von Tripp's Ferrari. And on lap 8, Moss went by Hawthorn and Berra passed Von Tripp's. The tail end of the field had already been lapped. The Philippines retired out on the circuit. After 10 laps, Moss was pulling away steadily from Hawthorn, for the Ferrari's brakes were showing signs of weakening and the van was led by 6 seconds. Hawthorn now gave up all hope of battling with Moss and settled for second place, for the Ferrari brakes just were not up to those of the van wall, even though the car had plenty of steam. At 20 laps, with Moss some 38 seconds ahead of Hawthorn, a slight shower of rain fell, and for a while it looked as though it might develop, but luckily it held off. Berra was firmly in third place, nearly 3/4 of a minute ahead of Lewis Evans, and Von Tripps was still only just ahead of Shelby, and then came Brooks, having been lapped by his team leader. Moss was lapping comfortably and easily faster than anyone else, very much the master of the whole race, and by half distance, 25 laps, he had almost a minute lead. By the halfway mark, Graham Hill was in a battle for last place, but then overdid things past the pits, and after one of the longest and slowest front wheel slides ever seen, the Lotus mounted the straw bales and settled down like a broody duck, with a bent chassis and an embarrassed driver, who then proceeded to help lift the car back onto the road, but it could not go on. The roads were now pretty dry and Moss set up a new fastest lap on numerous occasions, and his steadily increasing lead over Hawthorn became almost monotonous. Moss lapped Lewis Evans, who promptly tucked in behind and let his leader show him the way around, while Brooks moved up into 5th place ahead of Von Tripps. Almost at the same time, Hawthorn decided his lack of brakes was beginning to get dodgy, so he pulled into the pits on lap 35 to have the front ones screwed up. This stop let Berra go by and gain a 20 seconds lead. And though Hawthorn rejoined the race and set up a new lap record with an average of 175 km per hour, he had little hope of catching the BRM, for the Ferrari brakes soon disappeared again. At 40 laps with 10 to go, Moss was moving in to lap Hawthorn, who was still in third place, behind Berra, and Lewis Evans was still in Moss' slipstream. The leader had more than 2 minutes over the BRM, and on lap 41, Berra's car suddenly lost power and sounded woolly, so Hawthorn caught him on lap 42 and took second place. When Hawthorn broke the lap record, the van wall pit displayed a sign saying Hawthorn record, which Moss promptly misread and did nothing about. So the pit assumed the car or the driver was not up to any new records and left him to tour round comfortably in the lead. The remaining 4 laps saw Moss closing up rapidly to lap Hawthorn and taking Lewis Evans with him. Seeing that Hawthorn might not realize what was happening, his pit warned him that Lewis Evans was only 5 seconds away, but of course they could not tell him that Moss lay between the Ferrari and the third place van wall, as far as positions on the road were. There seemed every possibility that Moss might be able to tow his teammate into second place, but as they all started Moss' 50th lap and final, it could be seen to be too late, unless Hawthorn made a mistake. If you are still here, most probably you are enjoying this video, so please give it a like. And feel free to subscribe for more videos like this. It takes a long time and effort to produce these kind of videos, but sometimes they pop up around here. Let's proceed. The Ferrari brakes were still hopeless, and Hawthorne, seeing a van wall in his mirror, after getting a sign reading plus 4 seconds Evans as he passed the pits, thought it was Evans immediately behind him, leaving the main roads on the back of the circuit to go into the narrow side turning. The Ferrari slid sideways, and that allowed Moss to go by. Thinking his mistake had let Evans by into second place, Hawthorne was looking very unhappy as Moss went by. The van wall leader thought, "Poor old Mike, he looks really upset at being lapped by me." Whereupon he slowed down and waved Hawthorne in front again. Realizing the situation regarding the two van walls which had been behind him, Hawthorne was quick to take advantage of the courteous act by Moss and charged off down the hill to the seafront. Back at the pits, the three cars appeared in unchanged order from the previous lap, and Hawthorne crossed the line to start his 50th lap, still in second place, but almost a whole lap behind the leader. Then Moss received the checkered flag, and Lewis Evans was flagged off in third place, 1 lap and some yards behind Moss. Naturally, all three cars went on, Hawthorne to complete his 50th lap, and the two van walls to do a lap of honor. At precisely the same corner as on the previous lap, Hawthorne really spun this time and stalled the Ferrari engine. The two van walls, having finished their race, were coming along slowly to find Hawthorne busily pushing his Ferrari, trying to restart it. Moss stopped and sat with his engine running to see how Hawthorne was going to get on, while Lewis Evans went by and toured around to the pits on his own, much to the consternation of everyone who was waiting for Hawthorne to be flagged in second and for Moss to complete his lap of honor. Back at Drama Corner, many officials wanted to help Hawthorne, but he and Moss both waved them away. Having spun up the escape road, Hawthorne was pushing the Ferrari back towards the course, and was naturally so busy pushing and cursing his stupidity that he did not really look where he was going. Having got up enough speed, he jumped in and jammed it into gear, and at that point, the car mounted the footpath going in the opposite direction of the circuit. After a few hiccups and splutters, the engine fired, so Moss drove on and Hawthorne swung round in the wide main road and carried on to complete his 50th lap and receive the checkered flag. Meanwhile, of course, all the other cars had finished and everyone was waiting for the Ferrari. When all the shouting had died down, there was an embarrassing pause, for the officials had received a report from their observers that Hawthorne had restarted his car in the wrong direction of the circuit, and by the rules, that meant disqualification. It was not until 11 p.m. that night that a decision was made and Hawthorne was given second place. The stewards agreed that being on the footpath did not constitute the wrong way of the circuit, and they accepted confirmation from Moss, who was an eyewitness, that there had been no danger to any other competitor, for, as he so rightly pointed out, Hawthorne had been the only one in front of him when he got the checkered flag, all the other runners having stopped racing when Hawthorne spun. How to lose an F1 title 3 times in one race? While researching for this video, I saw something that I never saw mentioned before. Indeed, Stirling Moss did lose his F1 title in this race, and he did it 3 times. 1. By not setting the fastest lap. Moss was the fastest driver, and mid-race, he held an enormous advantage over Mike Hawthorne in second place. So he took it easier, not lapping so fast as he could. When Hawthorne broke the lap record, the van wall pit displayed a sign saying, "Hawthorne record." which Moss promptly misread and did nothing about. This was the first mistake. He could go faster and beat that time. Prior to this race, the cooling system of the car had been upgraded and he never reported problems with it. Unfortunately, the pit assumed the car or the driver was not up to any new records and left him to two round comfortably in the lead. They did not show that sign ever again. This misunderstanding between driver and pits, remember that there were no radios in the cars back then, meant that Moss lost a point and Mike Hawthorn gained 1 point. If they were equal in the end, Moss would win the F1 title because he had 4 victories against Mike's 1. The problem is that he had a lot of retirements due to mechanical problems and Hawthorn was always scoring points. 2. By being a friend and a gentleman. In the last laps, Hawthorn was in front of the two van walls of Moss and Lewis Evans, when Hawthorn, seeing a van wall in his mirror after getting a sign reading Evans 4 seconds behind you as he passed the pits, thought it was Evans immediately behind him. Failing to brake properly, he left the main road on the tightest corner on the back of the circuit, the Ferrari slid sideways and that allowed Moss to go by. Thinking his mistake had let Evans by into second place, Hawthorn was looking very unhappy as Moss went by. Here's Stirling Moss' second mistake, being a friend and a gentleman. The van wall leader thought, poor old Mike, he looks really upset at being lapped by me, whereupon he slowed down and waved Hawthorn in front again, realizing the situation regarding the two van walls which had been behind him. Hawthorn was quick to take advantage of the courteous act by Moss and charged off down the hill to the seafront. If Moss had kept racing on his ultimate lap and stayed in front of Hawthorn, thus being the only one to complete 50 laps, there would have been no mess after the race and Lewis Evans could have raced the Ferrari to the line for second place. Maybe he would have done it, removing points from the Ferrari driver title contender. By being a friend and a gentleman, Moss gave the chance of Mike Hawthorn to unlap himself and kept his second place in the race, avoiding a final fight to the line with his van wall teammate Lewis Evans. He didn't have to do that, and he could and should race to the finishing line. But by doing it, he showed again he was a true friend and a gentleman. But even worse was what was coming, resulting from this huge mistake. Something that would not happen if this mistake was not committed. 3. By showing true sportsmanship. The race is arguably best remembered for Moss' intervention in preventing Hawthorn from being disqualified, allowing the latter to retain second. Moss scored 8 points against Hawthorn's 7. As one of Hawthorn's 6 best results of that season, it allowed him to beat Moss to the driver's title by a single point. At precisely the same corner as on the previous lap, Hawthorn failed to brake on Antunes Guimarães' departure for Lidador Street. He really spun this time, stalled the Ferrari engine and was unable to put his car to work. Moss stopped and sat with his engine running to see how Hawthorn was going to get on, while Lewis Evans went by and toured round to the pits on his own. Many officials wanted to help Hawthorn, but he and Moss both waved them away. Mike tried to push it towards the circuit, but it was going uphill, so he turned the car around and, taking advantage of the slight incline and having got up enough speed, he jumped in and jammed it into gear. And at that point, the car mounted the footpath, going in the opposite direction of the circuit. After a few hiccups and splutters, the engine fired, so Moss drove on and Hawthorne swung round in the wide main road and carried on to complete his 50th lap and receive the checkered flag. In the end, the sport commissioners investigated the possibility that there was a violation of the regulations, because pushing the car against the direction of the circuit was prohibited, resulting in the Briton's disqualification. Stirling Moss testified that Hawthorne had pushed the Ferrari off the track and there had been no danger to any other competitor, for, as he so rightly pointed out, Hawthorne had been the only one in front of him when he got the checkered flag, all the other runners having stopped racing when Hawthorne spun. Finally, at around midnight, the stewards agreed that being on the footpath did not constitute the wrong way of the circuit, and they accepted the confirmation from Moss, who was an eyewitness. Thanks to that testimony, Hawthorne kept his points and ended up winning the World Championship 1 point ahead of Moss. This gesture by Moss in Porto remained in everyone's memory as one of the great gestures in the history of world motorsport. And boys and girls, this is how you lose the title you want so much and dream about. Losing it 3 times in one race is hard. This is like those airplane crashes investigations, where they find out that a series of errors have been made and it took only one of those mistakes to not have happened and the whole disaster would have been avoided. Destiny or not, Mike Hawthorne would only enjoy that title for a few months because he would die in early 1959 as a result of a car crash. The record. This race holds a record that may be unbeatable. While Damon Hill and Jackie Stewart won the 1995 Australian Grand Prix and 1969 Spanish Grand Prix, respectively by 2 laps each, the record for the biggest time difference between first and second is held by another British driver. In the 1958 Portuguese Grand Prix, set on the cobbled, tram-lined streets of Porto, Stirling Moss driving a van wall beat Mike Hawthorne in his Ferrari by 5 minutes 12 seconds. Maybe Stirling Moss was thinking about this record. In 1959, the Portuguese Grand Prix was held in Lisbon in the Monsanto truck. 1960. At the beginning of the 60s, the Boavista circuit received the 9th Grand Prix of Portugal, an event that would mark the farewell of the national and international motorsport stage circuit. Still, it could be said that it was a great farewell, as spectators had the privilege of seeing Jack Brabham's 5th consecutive victory that year, which resulted in the early victory of his 2nd world title. After the heavy accident in Belgium, in which he broke both legs, Stirling Moss took part in the Portuguese Grand Prix, although not in the best shape. John Surtees, in a Cooper Climax, was the fastest on practice. Also in practice, Henry Taylor crashed his BRM Cooper heavily and injured his arm, while Jim Clark smashed up his Lotus in a rare crash. Despite the accident, pole position went to Team Lotus driver John Surtees, who edged out Dan Gurney's BRM by a few hundredths of a second. Jack Brabham was 3rd quickest in his normally dominant works Cooper. Moss put his Walker Lotus on the 2nd row alongside Graham Hill's BRM. Brabham took the lead at the start, but Gurney quickly found a way ahead, and then Brabham went wide at one corner and dropped to 6th place. Moss emerged 2nd with Surtees and Phil Hill in his Ferrari fighting with him. After 10 laps, Gurney dropped back with an oil leak, and so Surtees took the lead, with Moss in pursuit, but he had to stop because of a spark plug problem and dropped to the back of the field. He was later disqualified for driving against the direction of the race while trying to get going after a spin, in the same place where Hawthorn ran off 2 years before, and most likely by doing the same type of action. But Moss, first because of his untouchable behavior and then because he was still not in the best of physical shape, accepted without even arguing. Brabham had a lively fight with Phil Hill until the American crashed, and this became the lead with over a minute of advantage over the second place on lap 36 when Surtees went off because oil had leaked onto his pedals. Bruce McLaren came through to finish second to give Cooper another 1-2 result, with Clark finishing third in his cobbled-together Lotus, his first podium ever. Brabham's victory meant that he clinched the World Championship with 2 races remaining in the World Championship. The first Portuguese driver, Mário Araújo Nicha Cabral, had the second opportunity this year to drive his Formula 1 in Portugal. The drive in the second Scuderia Centro Sud Cooper Maserati alongside Maston Gregory, but would eventually give up 17 laps from the end due to problems in the engine, missing an excellent opportunity to secure 5th place. This was an old car, very used, and rented by the ACP to the Scuderia Centro Sud so he could drive. I guess it would be a little miracle if it could get to the end of the race. To support the Grand Prix, and instead of the Formula Junior, this time the Automobile Club of Portugal organized some sport car races. In the city of Porto Cup, the times of the Portuguese car builders was gone, and the races now were held with normal cars you could buy from the dealer. Manuel Spratley won in a Volvo 544. In another race, Taça Secretariado Nacional de Informação, held with the best GT cars of the day, Moura Pinheiro won, driving a Ferrari 250 GT Berlinetta, beating António Barros on a Mercedes 300 SL. After these 3 races, it was necessary to wait until 1984 to get F1 back to Portugal. Reasons for the end. There are some reasons for the end of this circuit. First, the circuit would be an amazing Grand Prix course in the 1930s, but by the 60s it was clearly dated and needed renovations. The FIA demanded that the tram lines were removed, and that was simply not going to happen, as it was too costly and the trams were the main way of transport for the main population at the time. Then, the danger factor. There were many poles and trees around the circuit. The main straight and pits area were covered in cobblestones that was terrible for grip when it rained. The pits were really short, narrow, and were positioned near the seafront, so it was impossible to improve them in space or conditions. Another reason was the financial burden to the ACP, as the prices and fees to pay to the drivers and teams were high. There was a lot of people in the grandstands, but not always the money coming from the ticket officers did match the number of people watching. So there was a lot of side pocketing. Another huge tragedy was the loss of Jorge Novais in early 1961. He was the true soul of this circuit, its major driving force. The final and main reason was the preference by the FIA to run races on the safest racing circuits out of the cities. After the tragedy in Le Mans in 1955, safety started to be a word used in the FIA vocabulary. Anyway, it is very important to notice that despite some dangerous crashes and accidents, in 70 years of racing here, there was never any death to register on this track. If you think about it, it is remarkable, as it staged races in some of the most dangerous and deadliest eras of motor racing, when the fastest bands were all surrounded by trees and cars were getting faster and faster. Changes in the circuit. In 2001, Porto was the European capital of culture, alongside Rotterdam in Holland. The city hall took the opportunity to modernize the city, mainly the center and the river and sea fronts. The city park was extended to the sea, so the old start-finish straight was demolished, relocated and transformed into a bridge, which allows people to go below it and reach the seaside from the main city park. The roundabout is now a parking lot below ground. The fort is untouched, and they built the transparent building over there. That old house is the only survivor. It is a bar nowadays. And funny, the main road went through its front, now it goes through its back. This is the only difference that exists between the old track and the new. Of course, all now is covered in smooth tarmac and not with cobblestones. The tram lines are different. Most are gone. The tram is only for touristic purposes nowadays, and it runs only in the sea and river fronts, and also in selected streets of the city center. 2005. After 45 years of the last glories lived in the Boavista circuit and a huge effort to revive this old circuit, the passion for the racing machines, the smell and the noise of the engines have finally returned to the Boavista circuit with the 2005 Porto Historic Grand Prix. After the first three editions, 2005, 7 and 9, this event was the delight of racing and car lovers and a huge success on all levels, from the sport to the financial side. Porto City Hall played a fundamental role in making the dream come true. The roots of the physical structure remained in the Boavista and Circunvalação areas, where new infrastructures were built for this purpose. The start-finish straight was now set in the city external ring. There were months of work so that the Boavista circuit could receive, every 2 years, cars from the most diversified classes. From the 8th to the 10th of July 2005, a huge audience filled the stands and surrounded areas. One of the most spectacular classes in the competition was F1 pre-1961. Although they were not the fastest, the Maserati, Bugatti, Cooper and Alfa Romeo that were in the historic Grand Prix of Porto were amazing to watch, and many of them had already run in the Boavista circuit in the 50s. Unfortunately, there was a chicane installed in the Bela Cruz Café corner that caused a lot of crashes on several races. After the success achieved with the previous edition, in 2007 the event was extended to two consecutive weekends in July. The circuit has meanwhile been improved, with some improvement works aimed at increasing safety and competitiveness, like the removal of that chicane in order to allow for more and better races, such as the World Touring Car Championship. Over 112,000 people came to see these races. In 2009, once again held on two consecutive weekends of July, the Boavista circuit registered more than 200,000 spectators who filled the stands and visited the city. This event was a success at all levels, continuing to draw the attention to this unique circuit that has been forgotten for many years. In 2007, 9, 11 and 13, the track staged the FIA WTCC Race of Portugal, an event that included in its program European motorsport categories such as International Formula Master and several Portuguese national competitions. In 2015, the Porto City Hall decided to suspend the circuit, stating that following a cut in support from Turismo de Portugal, a Portuguese government institute, spending about 3 million euros on the event would be irresponsible. The WTCC race was then transferred to Vila Real, a city in the interior north of Portugal, a place that held races since 1931 and rightly considered as the heart of racing in Portugal. In a funny coincidence, Stirling Moss also won the race held there in 1958, as he did the F1 race in Porto that same year. And that's the closure of this new chapter on this beautiful city circuit. For now, there are no plans to revive the circuit. Wikipedia error. The map displayed by Wikipedia is wrong. The start-finish straight is not in the end of the city's external ring, but by the seaside, on a road that does not exist anymore, as it was demolished and moved 100 meters to the east in 2001. I have seen videos of video games where the start-finish straight is wrong, just like the Wikipedia map. Onboard. Alright, I have one onboard video for you, but it is different than what I usually display in here in my videos. Original onboard videos recorded a long time ago. In this case, I don't know about the existence of any onboard video about this circuit. I did a very extensive research and nothing. So I tried to do one myself, but there are some problems. First, the races were held anti-clockwise, which is the opposite direction than the traffic goes. Then there are speed traps, traffic lights, other cars, and so on. To fight this, I decided to go very early on a Sunday morning, install a camera in the rear spoiler of my car, and do a lap on the 1958 layout, trying not to have any cars behind me. I am also trying not to completely stop in the traffic lights, so I lift if they are red, and I go really slowly until they go green. Then I did speed up and edit the video in these small bits. In the end, if I reverse the footage, I have an onboard lap of this circuit with a front view. Another problem created by reversing the footage is the sound. It is not the best, but it is what it is. Of course, this is without the original start-finish straight that does not exist anymore, without the time element, so no cobblestones, tramlines, or the old people in the grandstands. This is what is possible to do. I hope you enjoy it. Let's go! Thank you.
Nella mia vita sono stata stimolata da molte persone, ma soltanto da un tipo di automobile. Una volta Fangio mi disse che guidava a una velocità troppo alta e quindi correndo troppi rischi. Ma a quei tempi e in quell'autovettura mi sentivo assolutamente impavida. Per me la sensazione provata guidando una Maserati è stata una delle fonti più costanti di piacere nella mia vita. E non ho dubbi che lo sarà anche per te. Sono veramente felice di aver passato la miglior parte della mia vita in gara e alla guida di quelle che per me sono le migliori vetture mai create. Ora ho 88 anni e sono abbastanza vecchia per ammettere che invidio la strada che si è appena aperta davanti a te. Credi a qualcuno che lo sa. I più fantastici chilometri sono tutti davanti a te.
Amazing racing stories. Right after his heavy crash, Tony Gaze was assisted by a family that was in that spot watching the race. As he did not present any major injuries, they gave him port wine to revive him. Duncan Hamilton, who had just won the Le Mans 24 Hours race 1 week earlier, also crashed hard after a touch with a Ferrari of Count Sturzi. He went directly into a pylon with electric cables, was thrown into a tree, and fell 4 meters to the ground. With all this, he ended being very lucky indeed. He was sent to Matosinhos Hospital, where he asked why everything was so dark. And they told him the pylon he crashed into was carrying the electricity to that hospital and that area. When he asked for water, he was told that the water was contaminated and he was given port wine instead, which he accepted. They started procedures and he asked why wasn't he being anesthetized. And they explained him that the anesthetist took the day off to go watch the races. He then asked why were there some nuns. The doctor told him that they were there to relieve his pain wherever as possible or to give him his last rites. Which one comes first? But he was happy, he was still alive, and later he was transported to the British hospital, where he stayed for some weeks to recover. He raced several times in the Boavista circuit, but he was never lucky here. And this is it. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, give it a like, subscribe for more videos like this, and leave a line in the comments section if you have something to say or ask. I see you in the next video. Take care.